by show of hands, raise your hand if you're the nonprofit. Okay, and then what about with resorts? Okay, and then school districts. And then we got some champions right here. What else? Municipalities, government. And have I missed any?
Restaurants.
Okay. Oh, restaurants. Yes, we got lots of restaurants. Okay, so now everybody keep your hand in the air. Raise your hand. And keep it in the air if you have a green team already established. All right. Well, that's a good representation, so I appreciate that. I think you're probably tripling up there, right? Well, I wanted to kick off the hour just giving a high-level profile of who McKinstry is, and that we were established 60 years ago in the Pacific Northwest, and we are a design, build, operate, and maintain firm that focuses on people and organizations and outcomes to ensure that the built environment serves the owners, the operators, and the occupants alike. So Americans spend more than 90% of our lives indoors. And that ratio might be a bit less here in Steamboat. But in general, we know that buildings squander energy, labor, construction, and maintenance costs. And so with that, our organization's vision is together building a thriving planet. And our mission is to take responsibility to efficiently develop, design, operate, and deliver the built environment. So we work with sectors including municipalities, school districts, universities, and commercial property owners to improve their efficiencies and transition to truly sustainable operations. So we may go into a building and retrofit the lighting and the mechanical system, and not to sacrifice the occupant comfort. But even with these great measures put in place, we see buildings drift over time because the users and occupants may not know their direct impact to that building's operations. We've developed and implemented strategies and put tools in place to maintain the performance of HVAC systems, but unless we've truly engaged the users, the operators and the occupants, we see those savings drift over time. And so out of this was born our PowerEd program, which really takes process and performance, where we're setting measures in place and we're measuring those and we're sharing that, reporting and dashboarding those results, but the people side of the house, where we're engaging those occupants and sharing with them their impacts and also measuring that and sharing those results. My name is Sarah, again, and I'm looking forward to connecting with those after. Please come up and feel free to grab some of our information up here. There's fantastic financial resources to actually implement further development of your sustainability programs. And Ashley's going to go ahead and jump into a bit about how our PowerEd program leverages community-based social marketing to engage and enthuse occupants and owners and all stakeholders to foster champions with those green teams and really shift behaviors and create truly sustainable, resilient, and accountable communities. So, thanks so much.
So, actually, we do have a lot of local experience. We've worked a little bit in the Route County area, but mostly on the capital retrofit side, so performance contracting and facility condition assessments with Colorado Mountain College. And can only do so much to a building without the occupants being engaged and having that green team or sustainable facility team really helping out with that. And so that's something I'm really passionate about. I actually did my master's thesis around behavior change at Duke University and how that impacts water and energy efficiency. Then I helped the University of Northern Colorado launch their initial behavior engagement program back in 2016. So we have a robust team in our office down in Golden that really helps with the building occupant side and building an engagement program. So there's a lot of challenges that you all face in rural Colorado, and I think one that we've seen over and over again, especially in this area, is being able to accomplish your sustainability and resiliency goals. I think those are two big buzzwords that we hear a lot now. But then also looking at just developing that in the first place, and so getting on board, building that green team, looking at how do you make sustainability and resilience goals, how do you baseline, where do you even start if you don't have them. So just some quick energy facts and the amount of impact you can make. So by 2030, the amount of electricity consumption consumption by Americans alone will increase by about 45%. That's the current projection. And out of that, about 72% of that electricity is from buildings. And so occupants in those buildings can make a huge impact on the amount of electricity spent in the U.S. over the next decade. And then out of the world, the U.S. uses about, or emits about 20% of the carbon emissions. So if you look at the population in the U.S. versus the amount of carbon we emit, it's a little bit unbalanced. And that's something each of us as an individual can make an impact with. So sustainability really looks at addressing some of these challenges from carbon, energy, water savings, but it also really hits a business's triple bottom line. So at this point, there's really a case for, you know, there's always the environmental case, offsetting greenhouse gas emissions, lowering energy and water consumption within your agency or your community, but it also really hits the economic point at this point in time. It lowers utility bills. It really helps to provide excellent financial returns, even looking at the behavior engagement side. We've worked with partners throughout the U.S. and seen up to 20% reduction in utility bills from behavior change alone. We'll go over some of those case studies, but there really is the financial piece. And then there's also the social equity case, too. So it improves your community facilities. It helps with occupant comfort, so looking at heating and cooling loads, and also just looking at air that comes in, but then also building up your community too. I think sustainability can be something that is really impactful and brings people together. And I know I've seen this across a lot of education campuses, especially, that it's something everyone can relate to, and it's a common cause that makes people feel more passionate often about their organization. The biggest challenge, I'm sure if any of you have started to build a green team, is getting people engaged. So there's a lot of psychology behind behavior change, and people can be predictably unpredictable, right? And so the hardest part is really getting that initial traction and getting some of that started. So one good case of this is, you know, what really influences our behavior. So I don't know if anyone has seen this graph before. This is looking at organ donation rates. So I don't know if anyone has a guess as to what the biggest difference between the green bars and the blue bars are. What's the difference in behavior?
Isn't one opt-in and opt-out? Is that?
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is just program design. Program design impacting behavior change. So all of the people in the green on the left it's opt-out. So they're automatically an organ donor unless they take that extra step to opt out of the program. The other ones on the left have to make that extra step to become an organ donor. So simply because it takes more effort to be an organ donor in these countries, they get less participation rate. And so that's just program design. And so that's something that you can integrate into a behavior change program, just thinking about program design. So one good example of that is recycling. So if you have your recycling and your trash right next to each other, people are more likely to recycle. If you separate your recycling bin, put it at one end of the room, and put your trash at the other end, people are more likely just to go straight to the trash and throw everything away. That's a behaviors, we talked a little bit about that, to find what works best with your organization, what your culture would look like with certain behaviors. Prompts, so whether that's little weekly email reminders, or sometimes we build a website for people so they can log on and see different actions they can take on a given day to just make an impact on their organization. Peer influence is a big one. Visibility, so signage. Again, maybe on the login page, you have little reminders for employees that pop up. Making sure that you have signage in the bathroom to turn the water off, little things like that, and that kind of ties back into communication. Feedback, I think feedback is an important one that a lot of people often forget. But once you're in the process of building a green team or implementing these policies, just see what people like and what they don't like. And this is different from organization to organization, but getting feedback is critical to the success of your program and being able to integrate that into your program and your policies to make sure that it's going to be a successful program. So getting constant feedback and looking at continuous improvement for your program. And competition is a big one. So we've done things like sustainable selfie contests where we've had different members of the organization take selfies for things that they've done that are sustainable, whether it's biking to work or composting at home. And then we've kind of rewarded some of the people with like free gift cards or free lunch. So incentivizing from these competitions and then just building up competitions in general and making it, you know, maybe it's department to department. So the finance department competes against HR or something like that. But I think leaving in competitions and making this a fun process for your employees is really good, and then having incentives that go with it. And then convenience. As much as we don't want to admit this, if it's easier for someone to do something, they're more likely to do it than if it's inconvenient. So this kind of goes back to the recycling trash example. If it's more convenient, if the trash and recycling and maybe composting are all right next to each other, people are more likely to do it than if it's all the way across the room. And we actually implemented this in our own office. We have a little green stuff in our office, and they actually got rid of all of our trash cans. So we have two trash cans in the entire office. And since it's harder to actually throw things away,
and pull the audience again here. And so for the folks that said they did have green teams, you know, are you checking off all these boxes? Are you finding some content here that could influence some change? Are folks actually reporting and tracking? Or how are you communicating? Anybody want to share? How about the high schoolers?
And the reporting and tracking through public dashboards. So we worked with the city of Boulder in developing their behavior engagement program, and we saw a lot of success with this as their specific dashboard that we designed, but we had a lot of competitions between all of their different buildings and the people in them, and we would rank them by the top 10 buildings just so that the departments could see where they were landing, and they could see the total savings, how many, what this translated to in cars off the road, powered, and so it would really resonate with everyone. So we had the cost savings for anyone who maybe was driven a little bit more by the finances, but we also had the environmental impacts. So we know it's not realistic for everyone to design a dashboard, but there's other ways to do this, like through the social media channels. Maybe you have an Instagram or a Twitter in your organization, so communicating through that, or maybe you're just putting signs up or having a whiteboard at the front saying, you know, we've saved X amount on utilities, which translates to trees planted, which translates to this. So just being able to communicate to your green team, sustainability team, and then anyone, your customers too, and your residents, show them a bit the great job that you're doing. I think bragging and public press releases and PR is something that some people can be bad at. Even if you're doing a good job, reporting out your impact makes a huge difference and makes people within your organization feel like you're doing something and they're helping you accomplish that goal, but it also makes your external stakeholders feel like you're being a good steward of your environment and your finances too. So I think that communication piece is really key. The second part is the building operator engagement. So getting your building operators and facility managers, if you have them, on board. So having them look for opportunity identification behind the scenes. So just little low to no cost opportunities, maybe looking at setting controls for the lighting so that your lighting maybe automatically goes off at night, scheduling your building correctly. These are all little things that can save a lot of energy over the course of a year. We've seen this save. We've had behavior engagement programs that save $200,000 a year because they're just shutting off their lights, running the buildings correctly, and really getting their building operators engaged. And then looking at the collaborative change piece too. So providing ongoing training and support for your building operators, making them feel connected to the buildings and making them feel like they're having that impact, and then looking at effective operations too. So just optimizing these systems and looking at some of the behind the scenes stuff within the building. So a few examples of this. This piece was actually really funny. So these people, I think this was at, this might have been at University of Northern Colorado, but this thermostat was right above a copy machine, and so the people in this office space were freezing all the time. The building was just being overcooled because this thermostat was reading that it was 90 degrees in the room because of all the heat coming off the copier, and these people had no idea why this room was so freezing all the time. They couldn't figure it out, and so one of our engineers that actually came through and noticed this, but I think one of their facility managers noticed this too, that someone had moved the copier right under this thermostat, and this room was just being constantly cooled, wasting a ton of energy. Everyone was freezing, and space heaters to offset that, which makes the problem even worse. So just little things like this that you might not even
target which market might be aligned with your business, and find resources that are very specific.
Yes, thanks, Sarah. Sorry, I forgot about that. We also, again, that link's at the end of this presentation, so we'll send a PDF of this presentation to you. You can just go to peoplepowerpoint.com, and there's a lot of good free resources there, too. So building occupant engagement. So develop your green team. Getting your steering committee with leaders and champions, so people who are willing to help lead and champion certain efforts, whether you want to break that up by water, energy, waste, transportation, whatever, maybe getting a leader for each of those divisions, but really developing that steering committee or green team and getting everyone from top level commitment. You want a diversified green team if you have a larger organization. So maybe someone from finance, HR, I mean, in higher ed, you typically get someone from each different division that includes student representation as well, multiple students. And then look at focus sessions and conversations. So I think this is part of the feedback process. So getting, what do people see needs to be addressed? What do people want to work towards getting addressed? Looking at priorities and what people are willing to work for. So maybe, you know, composting isn't a huge need in your organization, or maybe people don't want to do that. So maybe that's not something you focused your effort on. So just holding some focus sessions and starting the initial conversation on, as to what you want to focus on and what people are willing to commit to. And develop this within your organizational culture. Create the proper communication channels, so whether this is a weekly email, or maybe you do have a public dashboard that people can log into, or a website that people can log into, or a sustainability landing page. Just have that communication channel available and have it consistent and constant. So just decide what that is up front and make it known that this is where people go, or this is what they can depend on to get their sustainability news within your organization. So again, social media is great for this, or just like a weekly newsletter once a week on Fridays or Mondays, whatever day. And then fun challenges and activities. I'll give you some examples of this on the next slide. And then providing rewards and recognition. So if someone's doing a great job, you have a champion that's really going above and beyond, recognizing this person, whether it's a shout out in your newsletter, or maybe they get a certain parking spot for a month. Just figuring out a way to give them and reward them for what they're doing, and just taking that extra step, because this is most of the time a volunteer position, and people aren't. This is in addition to their full-time job within your organization. So providing that reward and recognition is key to keeping stakeholders and keeping the green team involved, but also feeling like they're being rewarded for taking that extra effort. So some engagement examples that we've done in the past that have been pretty successful. So tours, so if you have local nonprofits that are related to sustainability, we've done develop your sustainability plan. So you have goals, how do you accomplish those goals? And then implementing the sustainability plan. So you've had your action plan and now looking at maybe finding different champions to help you implement the plan. And then monitoring and